Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 17th May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and the page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of news articles are provided in the description box. And for the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping of news articles are also provided in the comment section. Now let us move on to the first article of the day. Now this news article is about e-waste disposal. The article appears on page number 3 in Chennai edition as a part of Chennai regional news. The article is relevant in your prelims preparation under general issues on environmental ecology and in mains in GS2, in government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and in issues arising out of their design and implementation. And in GS paper 3 under environmental pollution and degradation. First, let us know what is e-waste. See, according to e-waste management rules 2016 given by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, e-waste means electrical and electronic equipment discarded as waste in whole or in part by a consumer who could be a individual consumer or a bulk consumer. E-waste also includes those electrical and electronic equipment that are rejected from manufacturing, refurbishment and repair processes as well. Here a bulk consumer means bulk uses of electrical and electronic equipment such as say government, state government, PSUs, that is public sector undertakings, banks, institutions, etc. Now some examples of e-waste are, you know, discarded or abandoned mobile phones, abandoned TV sets, refrigerators, etc. Now this management of e-waste is important because of the problem of massive amount of hazardous waste and other wastes generated from such products. These hazardous and other waste are a great threat to human health and also to environment. Therefore, the issue of proper management of waste is critical for the protection of livelihood, health of individuals and animals and environment. Now let us see about the composition of this e-waste. See, according to the Associated Chambers of Commerce and Industry of India, computer equipment accounts for almost 70% of e-waste material, which is followed by telecommunication equipment, which is about 12%, and electrical equipment around 8%, medical equipment 7%, and the remaining, you know, are other equipments that includes household e-craps. Note that, you know, the plural form of the word equipment is equipment only, not equipments. Now the article notes that only 1.5% of the generated e-waste in India are recycled in an organized or a formal manner. Around 95% of e-waste are dismantled and disposed of by the informal sector. Now informal sector generally follow the steps such as, you know, collection of e-waste from rag pickers, then disassemble them for usable parts that have the resale value. The rest of the material is chemically treated to recover precious metals. Now they have inadequate facilities and because of that it may cause leaching of hazardous substances to air, soil and water. Also the recycling methods followed in the informal sector has low efficiency and the recovery is usually carried out only for valuable metals such as gold, silver, aluminium, etc. And note that it is expected that by 2020, that is next year, e-waste production in the country would become 52 lakh tons per year. The article states that a total of about 65 companies in the state of Tamil Nadu were brought into the ambit of extended producer responsibility. In simple term, it means that producer of an electronic or electric equipment has the responsibility to collect the e-waste and ensure that it is disposed properly. The producer has to channelize the e-waste by take-back system or by having collection centers. And the producer has to ensure environmentally sound management of such collected e-waste by having necessary arrangements with authorized dismantler or authorized recycler. The selling component is attached to the definition of the term producer in the rules. Such an arrangement of extended producer responsibility is also available with respect to plastics under the Plastic Waste Management Rules of 2016, which was recently amended in 2018. Now, the Rule 5, Subrule 7 of the E-Waste Management Rules 2016 states that any operation, you know, without extended producer responsibility authorization by any producer shall be considered as causing damage to the environment. Note that the term producer in the rules include even any person who offers to sell imported electrical and electronic equipment and their components. Another important feature of this e-waste management rules is the Rule 21. Now, it states manufacturer, producer, importer, transporter, refurbisher, dismantler, and even recycler, they are liable for damages caused to the environment due to improper handling and management of e-waste. Financial penalties can be levied for any violation of the provisions of this e-waste management rules by State Pollution Control Board with the prior approval of CPCB, that is Central Pollution Control Board. If there is strict disobedience by such entities or companies, which will result into action under Section 15 of Environmental Protection Act of 1986 and other legal provisions. Note that the manufacturer, producer, importer, transporter, you know, refurbisher, dismantler, and recycler are various players or stakeholders who are part of this e-waste management. And you are guided to have a look at all the definitions of these terms or these stakeholders in Section 3 of the e-waste management rules. With this, we come to the end of this first article. The practice prelim question will be discussed in the revision session. Now let us move on to next article. Now the next article is an open editorial about coalition government. Now this article appeared on page number 11 in Chennai edition and page 9 in other editions. It could be relevant in prelims under Indian Polity and Governance, Political System, and in mains under GS2 in Governance and Polity. It can be linked to challenges pertaining to federal structure. The authors discuss about successes of coalition governments, their contribution to economic growth, and why post-poll coalitions are popular in India in this article. So we know that the present central government is a coalition government. Now to understand the article, let's know what a coalition government is. See, coalition government is formed when no single party secures absolute majority in the Lok Sabha. In such a situation, two or more parties come together and they form a government under an alliance. Here, absolute majority refers to majority of more than 50% of total membership of the house of the people. For example, as the total membership of Lok Sabha is 545, an absolute majority in Lok Sabha means that is 50% of 545 plus 1, that is 273, right? If a party has, you know, 273 number, then it can form a government. If a party does not has the number 273, then two or three parties form together, come together and make the number more than 272 and they form a government. That government is called as a coalition government. But some experts argue that the present government is a surplus coalition government. Surplus coalition government means a party that already has the strength to form a government but has taken other coalition partners also. And the power of a surplus coalition is that if the other coalition parties disagree, then the other parties are no longer needed to be part of the coalition. Because if one party leaves, there will not be any trouble for the government. So this leaves a very little room for the coalition partners in the case of surplus coalition government to place their differences with the party that has majority. Now there are two important issues that matter for the working of coalition. One, whether they can frame policies. Two, whether they can manage to put up a working cabinet. Now the author differentiates ideological coalition from the coalition of convenience. An ideological coalition is one in which the coming together or the coalition is based on same ideologies. That is, political parties having same set of beliefs, ideas and ideals, they come together to form the government. Now this is ideological coalition. Now coming to coalition of convenience, it is formed when the sole motivation or the only motivation is to gain a parliamentary majority. Therefore, in coalition of convenience, we cannot find ideological coherence. Coherence means in the same lines or consistent with the same idea or logic. Now here the authors note that coalitions of convenience do not have coherence policy agendas. And also this coalition tends to be divided from within because of lack of cooperation. Moreover, coalitions of convenience tend to be more likely to be corrupt and they spend more money than the ideological coalitions. This is because everyone has got a hand in the pot, meaning that there are too many people trying to do the same thing and therefore it's bound to go wrong. There is one major criticism around the coalition governments. That is, coalition governments are inherently or necessarily unstable. The authors counter this fact by saying that it is not proven, particularly since 1990s. Now, in this context, they give example of coalitions at the center since 1990s, such as, you know, the completion of 5-year term under a coalition led by Indian National Congress in the name of United Progressive Alliance. Then one National Democratic Alliance or NDA, which was led by BJP, which also has completed a full term of 5 years. Now, the authors list some positives of a coalition government, which are, see, they bring certain degree of diversity and plurality of views. In a coalition government, there is diversity and plurality of views. Plurality means a condition where two or more principles coexist. Hence, in an ideal world where political parties represent only certain interests, there even a coalition of different parties can be more democratic or at least plural in views. Next is that coalitions are associated with periods of greater economic growth. And there is more credibility to the government's policies also, because in a coalition, a government feels it is the majority party in the coalition feels it is difficult to make radical changes as it has to be acceptable by all the parties in coalition. Now, some of the negative aspects of coalition, you know, first, there is a possibility that sometime parties in coalition are not adequately representative of the larger public, but only of smaller sections, regions and communities. In this situation, there is a lack of representation from the larger sections of society, which means, you know, sometime even coalition governments may not be necessarily truly democratic. Then, in a coalition, it is difficult for the party in majority to make big reforms of their own choice, in their whims and fancies, because they may not be able to convince other parties in coalition, and this will be seen as a hindrance by the party in majority. Now, to substantiate the positives and negatives, the authors give certain examples. One example given by the author is with respect to demonetization, which was one of the most controversial policies implemented by the present government. Here, one could argue that if this was a truly plural coalition, there would have been a deep thought given by the present government before implementing demonetization. Now, such controversial policies are hard to conceive in a coalition government where there are equal partners. The same would happen if the largest member of the coalition was truly dependent on the coalition partners to keep its majority number perfect in Lok Sabha. In present government, this was not the case because it had surplus coalition government according to the authors. We saw that it is difficult for the party in majority to make reforms of their choice. Then one can ask, how did the 1991 reforms happen? See, the authors say the 1991 reforms happened as a result of balance of payment crisis with no way to escape. So the authors say that in a coalition government, it is unable to make reforms of own choice in big scales. There is a possibility to carry out fewer big changes. Now the authors discuss about redistribution of funds in a coalition government, which is also featuring regional parties. The regional parties mostly represent sectional and regional interests only. In a two-party competition or tighter competition at a center, it would result in greater public good spending. But in a fragmented party system, which would be the most apt case of coalition government,
There would be a greater distribution of club goods, which would involve spending for specific communities represented by smaller parties in some states. Now, this is at the state level. So the author states there will be redistribution, but not necessarily in the way you would ideally want it to be. See, here, to understand the term public goods and club goods, you need to know what is rivalrous and excludable. A good is termed as rivalrous when its consumption by one consumer prevents simultaneous consumption by another consumer. And a good is excludable when it is possible to prevent consumers who have not paid for it from having the access. Now, public goods are goods that are non-excludable and non-rivalrous, and which include things, for example, like air, emergency services, national defense, like that. A club good is a resource that many people can use at the same time, and it is possible to exclude people from using it, such as satellite television, private parks, movie theaters. See, here, if you do not pay, you may not be given access to these. So that's the difference between public goods and club good. Now the authors discuss why there is a greater inclination to form post-poll coalitions in India. A simple reason is that in India, there is national level player, one national level player, and several regional parties. As the national party may not be willing to allocate more seats as demanded by the regional state parties before the polls, in the belief that national party will win the election with absolute majority. So many regional parties does not even try to form a pre-poll alliance. The same can happen in other way also. And the national party always seeks to expand its geographical reach across the states and also within the states. So in such situations, these parties seek to keep their ideologies within themselves before elections, because the regional parties may back off from supporting national party. And the national party plans only to play the ideologies after the elections based on the outcome. And a pre-poll coalition will work only if there was only state parties and no All India party at all, because regional interests will not overlap and will not be any conflict of interest. For example, say a regional party working in Andhra Pradesh can easily have an alliance with a regional party working in Tamil Nadu, because the regional party working in Andhra Pradesh is going to work in Andhra Pradesh only. It does not have any interest in Tamil Nadu, and the party working in Tamil Nadu will not have any interest in Andhra Pradesh. So there is no overlap and there is no conflict of interest, and it can be easily formed, the pre-poll coalition. And besides all these, there is also an absence of ideological coherence that would bring parties together for a pre-poll or a pre-election coalition. See, for parties to come for pre-poll alliance, there should be coherence in ideology. In such absence, there may not be a pre-poll alliance. Only post-poll alliances are possible. And there is one more reason for post-poll coalition. If parties go for pre-poll coalition, they need to allocate ticket or constituencies for the joining parties to contest the election. This would bring unhappiness and bickering or arguments among those who have worked for a party for years and have been waiting for a long time for a contesting ticket. So it is much easier for the parties to form coalition after the election, at the same time not keeping the party workers unhappy. See, this can be best understood. Say there are two parties, A and B. Workers of A do not like the party B, but somehow leaders of party B form a pre-poll alliance with the leaders of party A. Note that the workers of party A do not like party B. Now there is a pre-poll alliance. See, there will be non-cooperation among the party workers to make the one candidate to win. So to avoid all these challenges and these situations, such parties go for alliances after polls, after elections. That's the reason why they go for post-poll alliance. With this, we come to the end of this analysis. The displayed mains question will be discussed in the last session.
The next article is about proposed changes in the legal immigration system of the United States of America. The article appears in page 1 and 12 in Chennai edition and page 1 and 10 in Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The article is relevant under the prelims in current events of national and international importance and in GS paper 2 under effect of policies of developed countries on Indian diaspora. Recently,
the U.S. president has proposed to bring a change in the U.S. immigration system to dramatically reduce the family-based green cards. A green card is a permanent resident card that allows an individual to live and work permanently in the United States. Every year, U.S. admits around 11 lakh immigrants as permanent legal residents. These green card holders get lifetime authorization, you know, to live and work in United States and may receive American citizenship after 5 years. Now there are around 66% legal immigrants in United States only because they have a relative in United States, and around 21% of the legal immigrants were allowed their permanent residency through diversity immigrant visa program and as a form of humanitarian assistance by the US government. This diversity immigration visa program of US allows individuals from countries with low rates of immigration to the United States to apply for legal immigration, and they are randomly selected by the US government. Every year, around 50,000 individuals are allowed permanent residency in United States through this diversity immigrant visa program. Only 12% are in United States who are green card holders because of their skill, and the US president aims to increase this concentration of skilled residents from 12% to 57% by the proposed system. Now, the objectives of this proposed new system by the US president are to make the United States of America competitive with respect to Canada, Australia, and New Zealand in receiving the skilled human capital, and to protect the jobs and wages of American citizens, and to attract the best and the brightest from all around the world. This proposed new system is also called as points-based selection system, wherein points are to be awarded with respect to age, skill, type of employment offer, scale of advancement in education, and the plan to create new jobs. The young a worker, the more points will be awarded to him. The more skill a worker possesses, more points will be awarded to him. Higher the salary which is offered to a person who is applying, you know, green card, more points will be awarded to him. If an individual, you know, has a plan to start a company in United States, and if that has a possibility to generate more job opportunities for American citizens, then the particular individual will be given more points. So it is about point-based selection system. Now, basic requirement expected from applicants under this proposed system will be proficiency in English language, and also they have to pass a civics exam. Now, the US civics exam means a social science test that will deal with rights and duties of US citizens. That may include US history, US constitution, and the rights and duties of citizens. Now, if this proposal becomes an enforceable legislation, then it is expected that many Indians may apply for such permanent residency in United States, and in future to convert them to gain the US citizenship. However, there is a risk that they may not be able to take their relatives other than their spouses and children. That is, they can take their spouses and children, that they may not take any other relative with them. Now, this will also lead to already happening brain drain, that is, moving of skilled human capital from India to other countries, thus affecting Indian economy and development, as their knowledge and expertise will of no use to India once they leave our country in most of the cases. One has to note that around 70% of H-1B visas were given to Indians in the year 2018 by the US government. That is, of the overall H-1B visas given by the US government, 70% were given to Indians. Now, this H-1B visas are given to the temporary workers in the United States. Now, there is a huge uncertainty now among the Indian diaspora and others as well, that if United States government pass this legislation, that too with retrospective effect, that is law coming into force from a past date, past year like that, then they fear that many relatives, including parents and children of those US citizens who once arrived in United States as H-1B visa holders and now as permanent residents there, may be required to leave United States. And with this, we come to the end. Now, let us move on to the next news article. Our next news article of the day is regarding amoebic infection. See, this news article appears on page number 5 in Thiruvananthapuram edition only. The contents of this news article will be helpful in prelims under current events of national importance and in
general science. The news tells that one fatality has been reported in the Malappuram district of Kerala because of primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. Let us now see about this primary amoebic meningoencephalitis disease. The disease is caused by an amoeba called as Naegleria fowleri. This amoeba is a single-celled organism. This particular amoeba is commonly found in warm freshwater, shallow surface waters, and incorrectly, improperly maintained swimming pools, and also in contaminated lakes, rivers, and soil, particularly in warm climates. The reason why we say freshwater is that Naegleria fowleri is not found in salt water, and only one species or type of Naegleria infects people, that is Naegleria fowleri. Now let us see the mode of transmission. Naegleria fowleri infects people when water containing the amoeba enters the body through the nose. The Naegleria fowleri amoeba then travels up the nose to the brain, where it destroys the brain tissue. Note that one cannot get infected from drinking the water contaminated with Naegleria amoeba. An individual can only be infected or affected when contaminated water goes up into their nose. The amoeba then reaches the brain and it leads to the destruction of brain tissue. The person will suffer coma and then die. In its early stages, symptoms of primary amoebic meningoencephalitis may be similar to symptoms of bacterial meningitis. Also note that this Naegleria fowleri infection cannot be spread from one person to another person. The symptoms in the stage in this infection include severe frontal headache, fever, nausea, and vomiting, and later the patient may experience stiff neck, seizures. Seizures are a sudden, uncontrolled electrical disturbance in the brain, and the person may experience altered mental status, hallucinations, and coma. It can cause severe changes in your behavior, movements, or feelings, and in the levels of consciousness. And the mortality rate or the death rate is comparatively high in this type of infection, and there is no vaccine as of now available for treating this disease. Now we have displayed your prelims question. We'll discuss it in the last practice session. Now let us move on to the next news article. Now this article is about heat driving out animals out of a forest in Andhra Pradesh. Now this article has appeared in page number 8 in Chennai edition, 5 in Delhi, 6 in Thiruvananthapuram edition. The article will be relevant in prelims preparation under current events of national importance and in general issues on environmental ecology, biodiversity and climate change. The article can be linked to main syllabus under GS paper 1 in geographical features and their location changes in critical geographical features, and in flora and fauna and the effects of such changes, and in GS paper 3 under conservation. The news article discusses about the recent incident that happened in the Chittoor and Kadapa districts of Andhra Pradesh. Here the wild animals of Seshachalam Biosphere Reserve have attacked the human habitations in search of food and water. This is because the summer heat is touching around 45 degrees Celsius and there is deficit rainfall also in this region. So the animals are feeling difficult, and this is forcing the animals to enter forest fringe villages to quench their thirst. Very recently, on 13th May, we have discussed an editorial titled Protecting Forest Fringes. Now, if you want to have a look at the analysis, you may use the link that has been provided in the description box. That was an editorial. And coming back here, the intensity of heat this year is said to be the highest in the biosphere reserve. As a result, even shy and endangered species such as pangolin and the slender loris, which is regionally known as Devanga Pilli, are venturing out and risking moving out of their habitats. In one another incident, a forest official found a member of the endangered species close to a human habitation near the Talakona forest. Now this oppressive heat has not only led to vanishing of water in the ditches, ponds and streams in the forest, but also suppressed the moisture content in the soil. Now let us discuss in detail about Seshachalam biosphere reserve and also the endangered species slender loris and pangolins. First let us see about biosphere reserve. See, biosphere reserves are areas comprising terrestrial, marine and coastal ecosystems. Each reserve promotes solutions for connecting this conservation of biodiversity with sustainable use. Biosphere reserves are also called as science for sustainability support. Now, these are special places for testing interdisciplinary approaches for understanding and managing changes and interactions between social and ecological systems, which also include, you know, the conflict prevention between humans and the species and management of biodiversity. In other words, we can also say this as man-animal conflict prevention, right? Now, this biosphere reserves have three interrelated zones which aim to fulfill three complementary and mutually reinforcing or mutually strengthening functions. They are first the core area. The core area comprises of a strictly protected ecosystem that contributes to the conservation of landscapes, ecosystems, species, and genetic variation. This core area is free of human inhabitants and it remains absolutely undisturbed. Then let's come to the buffer zone. See, it surrounds the core area. It is used for activities that are with sound ecological practices, such as to reinforce, scientific research, monitoring, training, and education. Only these activities can be allowed in this buffer area. Now the transition area, now this is the part of the reserve where the greatest activity of human beings is allowed by fostering economic and human development that is socio-culturally and also ecologically sustainable. Now these biosphere reserves are sites established by countries and recognized under UNESCO's Man and the Biosphere program, shortly called as MAB program. Now this is to promote sustainable development based on local community efforts and sound science. The program of Biosphere Reserve was initiated by UNESCO in the year 1971. Now the purpose of the formation of the Biosphere Reserve is for in situ conservation of all forms of life along with its support system. Now see, in situ conservation is conservation of species in their natural habitat itself without moving them out of their natural habitat. Now the first biosphere reserve of the world was established in 1979. You have to focus in our preparation the words like first, largest, biggest, only when, if and only if, like those. So the first biosphere reserve of the world was established in the year 1979. Biosphere reserves are nominated by national governments and they remain under sovereign jurisdiction of these national governments where they are located. Now their status is internationally recognized. Presently, if you see, there are 18 notified biosphere reserves in our country. Now let us see about this Seshachalam biosphere reserve. It is located in Seshachalam hill ranges of Eastern Ghats in the southern Andhra Pradesh at the Chittur and Kadapa districts. It is the first biosphere reserve of Andhra Pradesh. And it is, in terms of India, it is the 17th biosphere reserve. If you look at size within, those biosphere reserves that are declared in India, it is the 9th largest biosphere reserve in India. It consists of 7 peaks, Seshadri, Neeladri, Garudadri, Anjanadri, Vrishabadri, Narayanadri and Venkatadri. The famous Tirupati temple is located at the 7th peak or the last peak, Venkatadri, which is also known as Venkata Hill or Venkata Chala, right? The reserve is home for nearly, more than 1,700 species. To be particular, 1,756 species of flowering plants. It is the richest floristic hotspot that has many endemic and even rare flowering plants. The forests of the biosphere reserve have certainly highly endangered wildlife species like, the slender loris, Indian giant squirrel, mouse deer, golden gecko, etc. More than 150 species of birds are reported. We have already discussed many of the endangered wildlife species such as Indian giant squirrel, mouse deer, golden gecko, etc. in our previous discussions of our daily news analysis. Now, in today's analysis, let us see about slender loris and pangolins that are mentioned in our news article. First, coming to slender loris, see, it is commonly found in tropical scrub and deciduous forests as well as dense hedgerow plantations that border the farmlands of southern India and Sri Lanka. The slender loris is a small nocturnal primate, meaning, you know, it is active at night. Now, it prefers to inhabit or live in thick thorny bushes and bamboo clumps where it can evade or escape from, you know, predators, and also there it can find insects, which is its main diet. Now, these animals are about, you know, just 25 centimeter long and have long thin arms. They weigh around just 275 grams. Their most prominent feature is the pair of two large brown eyes that are closely set. They spend most of their life on the trees. Though their movements are slow, they can climb very fast to the treetop when they are threatened. Now, these animals face a threat from poachers due to misplaced irrational belief that these animals have magical and medicinal powers. This hunting along with the destruction of their habitat is the major threat faced by these animals. IUCN has listed them as endangered, whereas they are protected under the Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of India 1972. Now let us move on to pangolins. See, it is commonly known as Indian pangolin. It is one of the 8 living species of pangolin, commonly found in forests, grassland, shrubland, savanna of India, Nepal, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. Indian pangolin is a large anteater and it is covered dorsally by 11 to 13 rows of scales. That is, covered in scales in the upper body. The adult male is about 1/3 larger than the female. Now, one special feature is that it has a sticky tongue which is longer than its body, and it is specially adapted for reaching and lapping up insects. Major threats to pangolin in India are hunting and poaching. These are done for local consumptive use as a protein source and traditional medicine, and for international trade for its meat and also for scales, particularly in Eastern Southeast Asian nations in China and Vietnam. Now, pangolin has been protected under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, and it is also listed as endangered in IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. Now, the displayed prelims questions will be discussed in the next session, that is prelims practice questions discussion. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion. Now, the first question is with respect to extended producer responsibility. Which of the following best describes the term extended producer responsibility sometimes seen in the news? The responsibility extended to the contract farming companies under the provisions of Prime Minister's Crop Insurance Scheme. The responsibility of the producer of electric and electronic equipment with respect to collection and management of e-waste. The additional liability of the manufacturer to a financial institution from which he or she has utilized the option of letter of credit. Now, we know that it's a responsibility of the producer of electric and electronic equipment with respect to collection and management of e-waste, right? So the option will be, correct option will be option B, Bombay. Now, the second question is with respect to primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. They have given two statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. Now, the first statement, primary amoebic meningoencephalitis is caused by an amoebic infection that damages the brain tissues. Now, this statement is correct because we know that the disease is caused by an amoeba called Naegleria fowleri. This amoeba damages the brain tissues, which will lead to the death of the infected person. Now, the second statement, sexual transmission of primary amoebic meningoencephalitis is possible. We know that person-to-person transmission is not possible in case of this particular disease. So anyway, sexual transmission is also not possible. So the second statement is wrong. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option A, one only. Now, we are in the third question. They are asking us to match, they have given protected areas and states. They are asking to choose the correct answer.
See, in these type of questions, you can directly attend the question if you thoroughly know which protected area is situated in which state. But some may feel it is difficult to remember all the protected areas. So just look into the matching pairs given there and try to recollect that within the given pairs, which pair you are sure about. Now, in this question, if you remember now from our discussion, you know that Seshachalam Biosphere Reserve is in the state of Andhra Pradesh. So here the correct pair will be B, should be related to 4. That is, Seshachalam Biosphere Reserve should be related to Andhra Pradesh. Now, this eliminates the pair that does not have B equated to 4. So options A and C can be directly eliminated. Now, in the remaining options B and D, try to match one more pair. If you are regularly reading the newspaper or watching our news analysis, you will know that recently in our previous discussion, we have covered about Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary. And from that, we also know it is situated in the state of Kerala. So C should be paired with B. So we have this pair in two options, A and D. So as we have already eliminated option A, the correct answer to this question is option D. As we have already eliminated option A, so the correct answer to this question will be option D. The next question is with reference to Slender Loris. They have given two statements and are asking which of the statements are not correct. Okay, so the first statement, it is a migratory bird which visits India during winter. Second statement, it is listed as critically endangered in IUCN Red List. If you look at the first statement, it says that it is a migratory bird. So we know that it is an animal, not a bird. So if you are clear with this fact, you will know that statement one is wrong. So you need not worry about the rest of the statement. Now the second statement states it is critically endangered, which is wrong as it is listed as endangered in the IUCN Red List of threatened species. So here statement 1 and 2 are incorrect. So keep in mind that the question asks for the statements that are not correct. So don't put option D, neither 1 nor 2, in a hurry. So before marking the answer, always once again look into the question whether it asks for correct statement or incorrect statement. We know that not correct means incorrect statement. So as here both the statements are incorrect, so the correct option for this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Both 1 and 2 are not correct. Option C is the right answer for this question. Now the mains question under GS2, C, critically examine the success of coalition government at the center and why post-poll coalitions are popular in India in the recent times. Now we have discussed the editorial article, and you can take points from there to answer this mains question. You can highlight the success of coalition based on the success of completed terms by UPA alliance, or one alliance by NDA government. All these things you can highlight, and you can critically examine. You can say, if you are taking this side, you can say since 1990s it has been mostly success. And you can also highlight, if you are taking opposite view, that you are going to say the failure of a coalition government, you have to highlight the examples that substantiate this point. Note that your example should not contain that of the states. The question is clear, telling a success of coalition government at the center. So make your answers relevant to the question, right? And you can inculcate the points that we have discussed, why post-poll coalitions are popular in India in recent times. With this, we come to the end of today's news analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, comment, share, and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates with respect to the newspaper analysis.